Thank you so much for keeping it Good Morning Kenya. Of course, the first part of the interview is on air. We are just about to talk about something that is very key and very crucial in the society, where we ask the big question, are men still men? That is what we want to talk about this morning. Of course, let me just give you a brief intro about what we are just about to get into before I introduce my panelists this morning. Long in the days in the traditional African society, roles were well defined, where men knew very well what they were supposed to do in the society, and women also knew what they were supposed to do in the society. Men were seen as protectors, as providers, and as just, you know, leaders of the home, and women were taking the submissive role of being caregivers, nurturers, and just home managers. But today, with education, with transformation, and with empowerment, things are taking a different shift, and we are trying to ask, are men still men? That's what we want to talk about today. And with me in studio, of course, I'm not alone. I'm joined by a great panel of discussion. I'm having a John Kanyoni, a facilitator at Transform Nations. I'm also having Esther Liana, a renowned gospel artist and a director of a Talent Awards in the US, and she represents Kenya. And she's also a mentor of the youth. And I'm having Edith Kemunto, who is coming from the Young Christian Women. She will give us her perspective on what she thinks about this topic. Karibuni sana to the studio this morning.
Thank you.
Okay, I'm glad to have you. And just to start us off, maybe opening remarks, starting from you, John, do you think there is a crisis in the male world concerning the role that they play? Do you think there's a crisis? Let's start there. Should we even be having this conversation?
Thank you. This conversation is healthy. And the truth is, if we look at what is happening in the society, there is need to have this conversation because there is a crisis. And the crisis, depending on the level that we can gauge the crisis, needs to be addressed before it gets out of hand. Like you have said in the introduction, long time ago, some roles were defined. Today, we find there is a lot of confusion in that. And therefore, there is need there for the society to address those issues so that at least we can get back there.
Thank you so much. Esther?
I would want to think that, okay, in as much as we want to say it's a crisis, but when you look at the way issues are, or the way long time ago it was, or in our culture, I want to believe that there was so much disparity in terms of women were more of subordinated and men were given the bigger role, or they were given the bigger opportunity. So for me, I tend to think it's more of bringing balance. It's bringing a balance to the society when women are empowered, and also men are doing their role. So for me, I feel it's more of bringing balance to the society. Yes.
For you, it's okay. We are doing fine.
Yes. I tend to think it's okay.
Okay, let's get it from Edith.
I agree with my panelist, John. We have a crisis. We cannot look past that, because the people making news, the people we see, are not the responsible men. We see the other side of the men. Mm-hmm. So while we may have responsible men out there, I do not dispute, I also feel like the other side is, you know, overshadowing the responsible side.
Mm-hmm. When you talk about we are not seeing responsible people making news, mm-hmm. a bit of clarification on that.
All right. I feel like we don't see more of the men who are providing, we don't see more of the men who are protecting, we see more of the men who are beating their wives, you know, killing their children and killing themselves as well. That is what we are seeing on the news. We are not seeing the, you know, the provider, the protector, the father, the husband. Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay. I'm glad that I'm having a man on the panel, and also ladies to just represent both genders on this discussion. One of the reasons why we're having this conversation today actually is to talk about the issue of empowerment. Empowerment was brought about to just, you know, bring women up there. But the more they come up there, it has now gotten to a point where it's becoming an issue for the men. You know, and I would like to hear from you, John. Do you think that as the women are becoming empowered, the men are becoming threatened? Do you feel threatened as a man?
It's not actually a threat. Let me put it this way, and I've said in a few other fora before. If you look at right from the origin, God created man. and created or made a suitable helper. Suitable helper. Mm-hmm. Now, a woman, by the creation of God, is a helper who is suitable for that man. Now, when now, as men, and I will agree, because that is actually what is happening in the society, when men now, we abdicate our duties instead of delegating our duties, because we have suitable helpers. Mm-hmm. So when the women now started getting empowered, and this started, yes, it's a long time back. You remember, I always talk of history. Mm-hmm. Before 1978, 79, there's no lady in the country who had an ID. Mm-hmm. So there's no woman who would even have opened a bank account. Mm-hmm. So it was all about men. But after that, and in the 80s, you realize now, because of the IDs and the bank accounts, women now started going to colleges. Women in the evenings would do evening classes. And as a result of that, chances now started now opening up. So women started taking up certain positions. Mm-hmm. And with that, now the men, what happened is, some of the men started now, with the delegation, getting now, abdicating the duties. You know, here all of a sudden you had a lady who was, yes, all the time. But now she has now started now joining up, even in contributing in the discussions about the family budget, about the family progress, about
yes,
the plot that
you. Yes.
So as a man now, it's kind of like, what's happening?
Yeah.
And when that came, now we as men, it hit us back. So it's not like a threat, but you'll find that most of the men would like the safe zone. You don't want that confrontation. Mm-hmm. And the ones that have become now confronting, now the women have tried to hit back. It's like, you are challenging me, but I'm also contributing.
That's the point, because now gender—it's gender equality, women empowerment. You know, let's fight for the girl child, which was a good thing. It was meant to be a good thing.
Yes.
But with the way now it's going, it's becoming like now a tug of war, like survival for the fittest. The woman is trying to come up. The man is trying to feel like, you know, if you come up too much, then you're getting in my space. I need to fight those, you know, things that make you so empowered. You see, and then we're having a scenario where men now are feeling threatened by this empowered woman. And if we refuse and assume that you want to live in the olden days where women never used to go to school, where women never used to be allowed in boardrooms, and where, you know, women were there to be seen. In fact, even in the barazas for elders, women were there to be seen, not to be heard. That is what was happening. But the society is not like that anymore.
I agree. And you see, the thing is, the women, yes, need to be, because the society is changing. With the technology coming in, with the advancement in all areas. Mm-hmm. So the women are no longer where they were. The men also should not be no longer where they are. However, the balance that she was talking about is, even as the women get empowered, because we are releasing, if I may put it that way, men have opened up for the women out for the empowerment. Mm-hmm. Because like we always ask, who is giving these ladies the opportunity to be empowered? It is the men. However, that's why I'm saying, as we delegate, as we open up, we should not abdicate our duties. And the women, therefore, should not think or should not have that feeling that because I'm getting empowered, then therefore I am on top. Now, the biggest issue has always been in the society, who wants more and who brings more? As long as you are together, you know, you came together, and even as the Bible says, you became one. Talk about the family resources. Because there is no individualism in the family. Mm-hmm. So whoever earns more, the question is, are you able to, because both of you are custodians, you're stewards of the resources God has given you, are you able to direct them for the purpose of the family and the society also?
That's a good question. Yeah. That's a good question. Let me hear from Edith also. And now that you, as a woman, like, what do you expect that the role of a man should be? Let's start there. What do you expect that the role of a man should be, so that we see whether that role is being met?
As a woman, I feel like the man should not neglect his traditional duties. Even, you know, due to the economic times, the woman has to start working. Because, you see, times are hard, if I may say. So the woman has to, you know, step up, help the man, you know, be a supporter, be a helper. I feel like the man should not neglect that. Even if the woman brings in more, even if the woman brings in less, we all have our duties in the family, and therefore let's play them responsibly. Let us all, you know, come together. Let me be the woman, let me be the support, and let the man be the leader.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay. Now, let me take you back to a point where we started, mm-hmm. you know. Long ago, roles were defined. Men were supposed to do this. Men were supposed to act in this way. They were supposed to be strong. Even at hard times, they were supposed to be, you know, you just have to be a man. Women were supposed to be the, you know, they were allowed to be emotional at some point. They were allowed to take care of children. But now we are shifting. We are seeing a scenario where men are taking a role of taking care of the home, taking care of the children. We've seen men in the streets with a kid walking along this. Long ago, you would not see that. Mm-hmm. A man would not touch a child. Mm-hmm. That is just something that was out of the question. Mm-hmm. Nowadays, we see even men crying in public. Leaders, some leaders have cried in public. Mm-hmm. You see? Now, women are also taking roles that were meant for men. Mm-hmm. Women are providing for the home. Like 100% you see homes that where the woman is in charge of everything. Mm-hmm. Is that a sign of gender roles being blurred?
First of all, we need to define what is gender and what is gender role. Because with understanding that, you can be able to come up now with a proper explanation or try to come up with a view of what is happening in our society. When you understand gender, the biological makeup of a human being, that is being female and male, and it brings up the, it has the hormones, which are different. The men are different from women. The genetic makeup is different. Then when we look at the gender role, it is what the society expects, the expectation of the society. So this is a thing that is created by the society. So it is not something that is supposed to be there. It is something that is created by the society. So when you look at what the society is telling people, is that this is how men should be, mm-hmm. and this is how women should be. But when I want us to, let me take you back to the word, because that is what I am. Mm-hmm. The word of God, when you look at God, the intention of God, it is true, he created man and he gave him the responsibilities first. But however, he saw that man was alone and he needed help. And this helper that comes in, what is her role? When you look at the word help, it is somebody who is coming to step in and provide, mm-hmm. you know, assistance to where this man is. You know, is going to have a little bit of problem or probably share ideas. That okay. is why I was saying we need to strike. It's more of a
it's
balance.
It's more of a balance,
because
Esther.
Man, uh-huh. when a woman steps in, it's not because they are going to compete. Like he was saying that when a woman steps in, it's more like when you respect the institution, mm-hmm. it is not about competition, but complementing each other and working towards one goal.
Working towards one goal, yes. Which is good, mm-hmm. Esther. But don't you think that as women are also creating this gap for mm-hmm. themselves? Because mm-hmm. when you're looking, for example, if you're a young lady and you're looking for a man to start a life with,
yes.
your thought would be like financially stable, strong. Mm-hmm. You know, you want that man to be strong, and you're defining that yes. man for already before you even get there. Mm-hmm. You want them to be perfect. You want yeah. them to get it all together before you get there. Mm-hmm. So how will you then go there and play the role of a support mm-hmm. when you don't want to see any weakness?
For me, it's more like my view is that when I want to settle down with a man, is that we will put down what our views are. He's working, I am working. Are we in agreement mm-hmm. with what we are doing? Is he comfortable with what I'm doing? Am I comfortable with what he's doing? Does he feel threatened? Then we can iron that out. What is making him feel threatened? Maybe it's the way I act. It's my behavior. Simply because I want to prove a point, mm-hmm. which I want to believe that when you're working, if there is no competition or something to prove a point, I don't see why a man needs to feel threatened when I'm bringing food on the table. Because one of the things is I am supporting him. I am coming in mm-hmm. as a woman and I'm saying, I am your help. Mm-hmm. So I am stepping in at that point.
Okay. Yeah. Let me get it from Joan also. Joan, in as much as she's campaigning so much for the need for support, which is good, don't you think that men also feel the pressure to get it all together before they get a woman into their life? Because most men would have an issue with receiving that support. I want to hear you. The male ego will just not allow you to receive that support. In as much as there are women who'd want to support you, then you'd see like, wait a minute, why do you want to support me? Does it mean that I'm not man enough?
let me say this. You see, when you're talking about support, and if we go back to the Bible, the one that I said, that God created a suitable helper. Therefore, the man, God said it's not good for a man to live alone, and created a suitable helper. So this help is God's design, because he saw man cannot live alone. But the man, and I want that a challenge now for us men today, the man has to be there to be helped. Mm. Because if you are not there, if you are already not doing it, then you cannot be helped.
You need help.
Yes.
He said it.
The other thing is, you've said long time ago there used to be roles that were defined and what have you. And we are confusing these days, because even as a woman is helping, even as a woman is bringing bread home and who is bringing butter, that becoming the issue. But look at long time ago. When you look at long time ago, even during the times of our parents, who used to go to the shamba? Mm-hmm. It is our mothers. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Who used to carry to go and fetch firewood? Mm-hmm. It is our mothers. Who used to come with a mtungi of, you know, water?
Of water from far.
It is the mother.
Off, yeah.
Yet when she would come in the evening after tilling the shamba, she would come and even prepare the meal. Mm-hmm. Now, I never heard long time a woman telling the man, I am so tired, I've come from the shamba, you go and cook today. Now, those days, that is the working the women, in my view, were doing. Today, those shambas are no longer there. Mm-hmm. Today, the shambas are where she has a job, mm-hmm. where she has a business. That is what she's doing. Mm-hmm. And therefore, what she brings from that business, what she brings from that home, is now what now comes to complement the family resources in the evening, and therefore we prepare. Mm-hmm. So I should not look at my wife in whatever she is doing as competition. It is complementary. And if she is doing more or earning more from the shamba and whatever, mm-hmm. by the way, I would still think that when I was young, my mother would earn more than my dad mm-hmm. from the shamba mm-hmm. compared to what my father as a salary was earning when he was employed. But there was never a crash of who is the husband or who is the man in the house.
That I would say that happened because it was well defined.
Yes.
The place of a woman was well defined. The place of a man was well defined. But nowadays, what comes in is that there are certain women in this campaign of women empowerment, they've gotten it wrong. You know, mm-hmm. it is they've gotten it wrong. Like, women empowerment is all about taking the space of a man.
You've
you
said
know,
it. Mm-hmm. You've said
that is what some think. You mm-hmm. know, and they tend to like, if I can bring food on the table, you can bring food on the table. Why should I be the one to go cook that food? Mm-hmm. I mean, we are both equal. That's what they ask. You see, and I wonder where the society is headed towards. But today is all about, you know, raising a generation of great men, even as we're trying to fill up that gap. Mm-hmm. Let me get it from Edith. You know, you're young. You have expectations. You are seeing what is happening in the society and where it's shifting from. Probably from your own view, what would be your ideal choice of a man? What do you think you'd want to see in that man that you want? You want to say that this is the choice that I want for myself. That got you off guard, right? I know.
My ideal would be, I still want a man who is financially stable.
My point, exactly.
Strip the financially stable. Listen.
You see, that is, uh-huh.
Listen. Strip the financially stable. Mm-hmm. I still want a man who can, you know, take care of my children, be there for when I'm gone. I still want a man who can nurture my, you know, babies. I still want a man who can protect me and love me. Even though I may be educated, I still want to help him. You know, we are human. We have weaknesses. I may help in a decision. You see, it's not 100%, he may not be right, but I may, you know, come in and give a suggestion. Mm-hmm. I want a man who can look at my side of things. Mm-hmm. And, you know, just consider that probably I didn't get it all together. Probably I didn't get the big picture, but now you know, thank you for your view and we can do this now. I want someone who can calm down and listen. Because even my side of the view is important.
Okay.
Now, there's something. Allow me to say something. You know, at the early age, and that's a pressure most of the ladies are having, young girls, young ladies, and pressurizing now the men. You see, when you talk about financially stable, it is like this.
He has
it's
to.
Like, it's like when you are fresh from college, and that's a cry today, you have no experience.
Yeah.
And wherever you are going to work, you are being asked for 5 years experience.
Yes.
That means you'll never get a job.
Yes.
And that is why most men today, young men, 28, 27, are still not married. Going even to 30, they are still not married. Because they are struggling now to be financially stable before they fast.
That's why I said, do men feel the pressure to get it all together fast before they allow a woman to come into their
and
life?
And it is the wrong
and
pressure.
And are women
now
the ones creating that pressure?
Yes, you've heard it. That is where we are.
Can I
would like to defend myself.
I think working with young people, I've worked for like 8 years with, 8 to 10 years with young people. And I want to believe that a male child, I'll cry for a male child because women are so empowered. When you go to girls' school, girls are being told you can make it. There are opportunities out there. So they are so empowered. But I worked in a situation where I was dealing with boys. But the expectation of the society, we are telling boys, do not be emotional. You're a man. So there is no, you're supposed to come out of, you know, you can't come out of that shell. It's like a prison you're in. So these boys grow up struggling with issues inside them, yet they cannot express them. And here we are women who are empowered. We come on to them and we tell them, I want you financially stable. So they are battling with issues of themselves. They are not allowed to cry in public. They are not allowed to express emotions. They are told you are supposed to be a man. So what will these young men do? That's why you find at the very young age, most of the highest percentage of boys who are getting into deviant behaviors, it's because they have no one to talk to because they cannot express that to people. They cannot tell people what they are feeling because the society is not allowing that. And for me, I would say we need to empower men from a very young age so that when they come to be men now, they can be able to stand up to this woman who is empowered.
Wait a minute, Esther. We need to empower men.
Yes.
I mean, John, do you think it's about time that the empowerment debate should actually just go to the men's side? Do you think they need to be empowered?
Yes, and let me pick up again now from what Esther had said, the balance. Because we should not forget that balance. Because the big question is, who will marry these empowered ladies? If the men are not there, who will marry these empowered ladies? And that's why we're having problems, a lot of problems in the marriages. In the society, yes, we empower the ladies. Remember I said, from 79, the ladies were like, they were oppressed. But when now they started sprouting up and the opportunity, we forgot about the boy. Yes, it is true. We always tell the boy, be strong. You are a man. You should, right? But to the lady, we are nurturing and giving up the opportunities. Look at all the opportunities that we are doing to the girls. Everything, even in primary schools, it is only about the girls and the girls. So the boys are feeling now, they are already sidelined. The boy are not now ready, even the self-esteem, they don't have it. That's why you talk about grooming of the boys. We're still even talking about grooming of
the
boys.
Let me ask you something that just crossed my mind. You know, for women, it's easier for mothers and to sit down with their daughters and take them through the process of life. You know, teach them how to cook, teach them how to clean themselves and just prepare them for life. But men, they don't speak. Like Esther said, they're taught to be strong. You just don't speak about your weaknesses. You just don't correct me. I'm a man. I'm supposed to stand up for myself. Do you think that would cause a challenge in terms of mentorship and, you know, just educating men and bringing them up? Do you think there is lack of mentorship?
Yes, yes, it is true. The men, and I will say this, the fathers of today, not of yesterday, the fathers of today who are we, most of us grew up in ways that we were not brought up by our fathers. So we never got that transformative ideas and transformative way from our fathers. So we are now called upon to be fathers, we are fathers, to bring up children without the qualities of being a father, of being a man, of being a husband. So if we never saw it it is difficult for us to be able to give it out. Mm-hmm. That's why that nurturing, that mm-hmm. debate is much more important. In Transform Nations, there are two programs for the men. Starting from the boy child, mm-hmm. there is now the boys to men. In secondary schools, those boys, you know, nurturing them and showing them how do you transform from boys to men. Mm-hmm. And then at a later stage, now the program that I'm much involved in, the Man Enough program, mm-hmm. where in this Man Enough we are talking about, now when we are talking about financially stable, we are talking about not financially stable, yes, I may not have the money now, mm-hmm. but do I have the potential? Exactly. Am I selling myself out?
Okay.
Do I have the potential to be financially stable?
Let me bring her in.
Later on.
She just reacted so nicely to that.
She's agreeing with me.
you know, it's not about having the money now, but does that man have the potential? Do you think ladies are patient enough to discover that potential?
Well, you see, if we are raising a generation where a man expects a woman, you know, to go defensive, I expect you to have the money. And therefore, if you don't have the money, you want to act like you're the victim. So no, because I don't have the money, I'm not able to get a woman who is good enough for me, you want to act like you're the victim. So we should, you know, transform from that. I would like to use your term. Mm-hmm. Transform from that. Let us bring up men who, you see, know that getting the money is a process and who are willing to go along the way. And let us also bring up a generation of women who are able to know that this may take some time. However, I'm willing to wait. Mm. Yes.
But do you think it's possible? Let me take a scenario where even mothers and parents also sometimes are to blame for, you know, putting this on their kids. You take a man home or you go say that I'm ready to get married, I've met someone. The first question, what does he do? You know? Before even he asks which church does he fellowship or even fathers would ask their daughter, anafanya kazi gani? You know, that's the first question.
It's
Do you think this is wiring the ladies?
Mm-hmm. And this is where we also need to change, mm-hmm. to ease even that pressure now on our sons and the men who are there. Because it's a question of what we advocate for, like in the Man Enough program now. This man, a man who can take initiative. Because that's a responsibility, be it security, be it in the financing. Is it a man who can take initiative? Is it a man who is going to live responsibly? Mm-hmm. Because that's the assurance that we need to give to the lady. Mm-hmm. I will live responsibly. And then I will also lead sacrificially. It's not a question of out of what I'm going to get. It's me as a servant of God, me as a man to be able to serve my family and my community. Am I ready to be able to lead sacrificially? Then will I love faithfully? Mm-hmm. And the lady should have said amen. Mm-hmm. Because in that sense, that's now, those are the qualities of me mm-hmm. as a man, mm-hmm. that I will also love faithfully. And lastly, am I a man who is ready to leave a legacy in years to come? Mm-hmm. What is it that I will be known for? What is it that my family will be known for? Because you, in the African culture, you hear of the clan of so-and-so. In my, where I come from, we talk of Mbare of so-and-so. So mm-hmm. things have changed. It used to be my great-grandfather, my father, that today people are talking of Baria Kanyoni. So it is from me now. What is it that now from my family, what is it I'm known for?
Wow.
So if I bring up my family with those qualities, that I'll also have integrity. Mm-hmm. Because as I live, naturally, whether I want it or not, I'll be mentoring. Mm-hmm. Whether I'm speaking to the people or not. Mm-hmm. To my children, I'm a mentor. To the society, I'm a mentor. Mm-hmm. So what is it that I am in there for? Am I loyal even to the society? Mm-hmm. Because people are looking up at me. Do I have a reason, to crown it all, to give my family, my wife and my children, a reason to be proud of me?
To be proud of you as a family.
Because I have given them my name. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They are sharing my name. They are all known by my name. Mm-hmm. So what is it that they are proud of that name?
Okay.
So if I have the man that Edith was talking about, a man behaving badly, mm-hmm. is my wife happy about that? Mm-hmm. Is my children happy about
that? Are they proud to call you father?
That's the
thing. Are they proud mm-hmm. to walk in the estate and say, that is my father?
Yes.
Now, that's the question.
The boy that you are saying, if you go to Kebira and, sorry to use that, mm-hmm. you'll find parents, those fathers, as long as they're there and for their with their children, even in tattered clothes,
yeah.
there is that connection mm-hmm. if the man has been there. It's not about finances. Mm-hmm. But there is that relation. Yeah. This is my dad. The mm. kid is happy, he's happy to be told, this is my dad. Mm-hmm. But look at even the upmarket where we are talking about finances. Mm-hmm. You never meet with your son. Mm-hmm. I know of a family where a father meets with his son who is in boarding school twice over the holidays. Mm-hmm. The day they close, mm-hmm. report form. And the day they're opening, how much
it's
are you going
true.
Up with? You see?
And then there's never that conversation.
Yeah. There's never that conversation.
What have you been through?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, let me let me get it from Esther. You know, let's go back to where we started about roles. We've taken a shift to financial and all that support and power and all that. But do you think that now that the woman is empowered financially, the man is empowered financially, they still need for the roles to remain the way they used to be, or we can just, you know, do whatever you think you can do?
For me, when you look at the society, when it talks about equality, for me, I don't really, like I've said, I don't really work with that term equality. It's more of diversity, because we are diversified. Our roles are very different, and we are created to do different things, and our strengths are in diversity. So when we do different things and we bring it together, it complements and brings the beauty out of it. So I want to believe that when the society will scrap out that idea of equality, because this equality thing is what is killing our society today. And when you talk about equality and you tell a woman, you're an equal person to a man. No, God did not create that.
There's a saying that goes that, you know, a woman who seeks to be like a man lacks ambition.
It's true.
Yes.
Let me bring the Proverbs woman. You see, God created a woman, a very industrious person. And if you read her story, she's told she's supposed to work, go out to the field and do the work, then bring it home and become the pride to the husband.
Would you be that Proverbs 31 woman, Edith? You go, you fend, you look for, you tafuta everything. The man just, you know, is proud that you are the wife, and they sit there, the woman...
Let me clarify that, because I don't want it to be misquoted. When it's said that, it doesn't mean that the man sits down.
Okay.
Let me tell you, if a man empowers a woman, you see, when a man comes, my man comes and tells me, Esther, you can do it. What will happen is that the industrious ability in me will begin to function, and then I will become this person that brings in, you know, I build a castle around him. And that's why you hear this quote saying, behind every successful man, there is a woman. It is the brain. You know, God gave this woman the ability to work faster than the man, not in a bad way, but they're supposed to really, you know, when you're a helper, you're supposed to really bring out. And when you empower a woman, you empower the whole world. Make the world beautiful.
I like the way, Esther, you're just, you know, bringing both genders on board. I like what's coming up on this side, because it's not about competition. It's not about equality. All of us are unique in their own way. And one thing that is coming out here is that lack of support, if we don't work together, then it's going to be a crisis where we started. Let me hear from Kemunto. Do you think you're that woman who is willing to go out of her way to build her man?
Yes. Yes, I am. The Proverbs 31 woman. Yes, I am.
Okay.
And I just want to agree with Esther and say equality may not work, but equity works. Let's all take our roles. Even if I was unfortunate, you know, to get one of the not so good men. Maybe he's a drug addict.
What do you mean by not so good?
Maybe he's a drug addict. Maybe he's an alcoholic. Maybe he does not, you know, treat me right. Maybe he does not bring food to the table. Probably he does not, you know, even take care of my children, ask them how their day was. It still is up to me, you know, to help my children respect their father. It's still the role of a woman to, you know, just help the children understand that this is your father. You need to respect him as thus. And I feel like as a woman, the supportive role that you have been given, you have to play it and play it just fine.
Play it very well. Mm-hmm. You agree?
I agree.
You agree? But this would only work, John, if men are willing to take the support. If men are still wired to believe that once I receive support from a woman, then I'm weak, then this support is never going to be appreciated. I don't know what you have to say as a mentor of young men out there to be able to change this mindset that if a woman gives me money, if she pays my rent, if she's the one running my family, then I'm weak. Even parents of the man would always be telling the man, you know, you need to go out there and do something. The woman will soon start disrespecting you. What can you say to change that mindset?
Good, I agree. And that's why now in the program I'm involved in, Man Enough, in the facilitation, I've talked about a man who takes initiative, a man who lives responsibly. You know, when we're talking about living responsibly, then we are talking about from what Esther has said. What the family resources that have come in, I am responsible to make sure that they serve the family. I don't, the woman is empowered, yes, my wife is empowered, she goes there, brings in, whatever she brings in, I don't squander. I don't take it because it's not me who has gone out for it. It's not me who has sweat for it that I'm going to squander. No, I appreciate that this is what God has given us mm-hmm. from the virtuous woman, mm. my wife, and now I have the family resources. Then as I live responsibly, then I'm also talking about loving faithfully. Because if I'm loving this woman, mm-hmm. then I will also value what she's bringing in, mm-hmm. in terms of resources, in terms of ideas. But much more so, other than that, we also mentor the roles of a man. We have, a man has to stand on the four pillars. A man who is a king. Mm-hmm. And a king does not, a king is not a dictator. Mm-hmm. You have to love with passion. You have to love, you have to lead with love. You have to give direction. Mm-hmm. Does your family know where you are headed to? Because if my family doesn't know where we are heading to, then I'm taking a walk, I'm alone. I'll not get any support from them. Unfortunately, that is what is happening in most families. Mm-hmm. I am, other than a king, I'm also a warrior, as a man. A warrior to protect my family. Protect even from the media. Not what we are doing now. You know, from the social media, from okay. the destructive media, mm. right? Mm. Protect my family. Mm-hmm. Protect even the family resources. That's why I come in.
Okay.
To protect the family mm-hmm. resources that God has given us. That should be the man that we're supposed to be. Mm-hmm. I'm a man who is supposed to be a friend. Mm-hmm. A friend to my wife, a friend to my family. Because that is where the connection now comes in. Mm-hmm. That is how I can be able now to impart the masculinity to my children. And not only the boys, even the girl herself. Mm-hmm. I'm supposed to call out my daughter into womanhood. Mm-hmm. The mother will nurture mm-hmm. her, okay. but I am the first man that she will ever love.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
right?
That's true.
And depending on how she loves me, that is how she'll go out exactly. there.
And you know the kind of man of that you are
yes.
would define how she will be looking at men.
Yeah.
Because
true.
Now her definition of a man is the father.
Mm-hmm. That is why he today in like marriages, the marriages mm-hmm. that we are having, when the man has taken the back seat, mm-hmm. the woman, the lady, is trying to look for the husband out yeah. of this man. Mm-hmm. And the only husband that this lady has seen was her father
yes. mm-hmm.
to her mother because he was a mother.
Okay.
So when he doesn't see those qualities, then there's a problem. Mm-hmm. And then lastly, even as we do all that, is a man who is a mentor. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You talked about four pillars. That was the king.
The king.
That was the friend.
The warrior.
The protector.
And then now the mentor.
Mm-hmm.
Because in mentoring, these children are a gift that I've given to God.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So I mentor them. I bring them up in the way they should go. So that when they grow up, they will not depart from it. That's Proverbs 22.
That's the Bible. Wow.
Yes.
Can
Thank
I
you.
Add something
well, do.
On what he
mm-hmm.
said? I'll just add on the protection side. When you're talking about protection, men are protecting. You know, it's not only the physical protection, mm-hmm. but we're talking about this woman that God has given you. You need to take her and protect even her dreams, protect her ambitions. When you come in, you stand in, you know, she will look up to you because she's looking at the person who is supposed to, you know, first of all, God gave roles to a man. And one of the things, a command was to create. And creation, to me, it's not just about, you know, going to create something, but creating beauty out mm-hmm. of a woman. Mm-hmm. And creating beauty out of a woman, it's in how you handle her. It is in what you say to her. And women don't need material. I will stand that because I'm a woman. Mm-hmm. It is not about material things. What women need to hear, it's feel secure. Hear the word of the husband. You know, God commanded a man, love your wives. Why? Because it is the hardest thing for the man to do. And he told woman, be submissive. Because God
yeah,
put
true.
An industrial role in a woman. Mm. So he knew a woman can do anything by herself. She can stand by herself and, you know, do anything, create anything.
Mm.
But now, when she's so empowered, she's powerful in that when she gets that, you know, she becomes that creative, she might
forget.
Take the role of a man. So that's why God commands mm. the woman
to be submissive.
Be submissive.
That's a
and those
point.
Those roles mm. needs to work together because if a man is able to love a woman, that is caring for the emotional needs of a woman. Then the woman will take care of the physical need of a man, and then they come together. And you know, it mm. merges. That's why, you know, it's a rib. It it joins together and complements. You become one,
okay.
And there is no competition in that.
It's not about competition,
yes.
Of course. And mm-hmm. I like the conversation.
Mm-hmm.
It's come out that everybody now is very important.
Mm-hmm.
As you just about to bring this to a close, the question was, are men ceasing to be men? We've discussed,
yeah.
We've shared. Now we want to know, are men ceasing to be men? As we close, Kemunto.
That is a tough question. It's a yes and no. Judging from, you know, the statistics, the rates or the single parents, mm-hmm. single mothers especially, the numbers are rising
mm-hmm.
tremendously. It is worrying. Mm-hmm. And you know, it's not just as a result of death, unfortunately. It's also as a result of divorce. It's also as a result of abandonment. So if I was to look at that very literally, I would say probably men are ceasing to be men. Probably they're not owning up to their tasks. If I was to look at the statistics, you know, just blindly, I would say, yeah, I agree. Probably the men are not just doing their part.
Okay. That's her thought, Esther.
I want to say, I will not say all men. I would give a percentage.
Oh, okay.
Let's give a percentage. Though I would say that we are losing in our men slowly. What is the image of a man is slowly diminishing in our society. Why? Because of the issues of empowering only one gender.
Okay.
And I would say if our society, I would call on to everybody to get out this in their mind that we only need to empower girls, but mm-hmm. we also empower boys. We start at a very young age.
Mm-hmm.
We stop just, you know, women, when they start, they have taught their roles right from when they know how to speak.
Okay.
A girl is taken to the kitchen mm-hmm. and taught, but a boy is never given the chance to spend time with the father
mm-hmm.
and, you know,
okay.
do what a man is supposed to
okay.
do.
Okay.
So they need to be taught
okay.
that we
okay.
empower men.
Briefly from John.
Right, two against one. the truth is, like I started by saying,
mm-hmm.
yes, there is the crisis. The level of the crisis, depending on how we look at it, is the question. But the truth is, yes, there is need to address that issue.
Mm-hmm.
Most men have abdicated their roles and their responsibilities.
Mm-hmm.
That's why we are having a lot of challenges in the families, in the community. And it's high time that men now started getting back. That is why we in Transform Nations have actually that program, the Man Enough program, close to about 10,000 men now have gone through the transformative.
Mm-hmm.
And when we hear the stories, and the stories much more so, we hear them from the wives, we hear them from the mothers, we hear them from the children
mm-hmm.
who are now saying, yes, I have seen my father back. Yes, I have seen my husband back. Yes, I have seen my son back.
Mm-hmm.
Then there is transformation.
Mm-hmm.
Because now when those families are getting transformed, then the society is getting transformed.
Okay.
So it is important that the mentoring now continues.
Okay.
That men now seek. Yes, it is true, there is that crisis.
Mm.
But it's not all lost.
Mm.
That willingness. Because if the men that I'm talking about have who have been transformed,
mm.
me inclusive,
yeah.
I wish I had that. So that being the case then,
mm.
then there is room now for getting back.
Okay.
The society lost it, but there is time to redeem it. And the faster we redeem it, the better for our families and for our society.
Thank you
mm-hmm.
so much.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for sharing with us your thoughts this morning. Of course, it's been a very constructive discussion here. Men are men ceasing to be men? The question that we asked when we were beginning. And we found out that it's not about the men, it's not about the women, it's about working together. Women empowerment should not be about trying to be men. We cannot be men. A woman who tries to be a man lacks ambition. Let's support one another, and men appreciate the support from women. Thank you so much. My name is Safin Achieng Ouma. Keep it Good Morning Kenya. Eye on Politics is hitting your screen in just a moment.